Thank you for joining with us this morning. We're here to worship the Lord, and we invite you to join with us. It's a wonderful privilege to be able to come and worship together with all of our family. And even though we're separated from you by distance, we're not separated by spirit. And so we just ask that you would join with us this morning as we worship our great God. This morning, our scripture text is found in Zechariah chapter 13 and verse 1. And it says, "On that day, a fountain will be opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and impurity." Join us as we sing this wonderful old song, "There Is a Fountain."
Power
a wonderful old hymn that everybody knows very well, I would imagine. We're going to be singing Victory in Jesus. And I want to remind you this morning that Jesus does provide us victory. I'm so glad that's true. We can have victory in Jesus. Join us as we sing this wonderful song.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again and cause the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is to Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. Love me, I knew Him, and all my love is to Him.
a special treat for you. I don't know if you knew about this or you thought about it, but today is Mother's Day. And we have a little special treat for you, and we're going to surprise you with that right about now.
Happy Mother's Day.
Mother's Day, Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Say Mom one more time.
Mom. There you go.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
I love my mom because she helps me with my online homework and she makes it easier. And she teaches me how to think of the thing I'm stuck on in an easier way.
I love my mom because she does a lot for me.
Our mom's the best because she takes care of us when we get hurt.
She's always dependable. She always supports me no matter the situation and loves me and encourages me always.
I love my mom because she tells me funny stories and she makes me laugh.
I love my mom because she tells jokes. She loves me. Actually, I love her.
My mommy is the best because she is really sweet and she gives us hugs and kisses all the time.
I will be hugging my band because you draw me up, need me do it so much. I appreciate it so much of you. You might be my life always. I'll be happy to see you about our life. And thank you so much.
Because she takes care of me.
I love when my mom spends time with me. It is sacred time. Sacred times. I wouldn't trade it for the world. She's my favorite person ever. I love her. Love Kaylee.
Because I love her.
I love my mom because she helps me through things and she's my best friend.
Hey Mom, happy Mother's Day. We know these are weird times, but we still love you and we just wanted to say
Happy Mother's Day. Thank you for everything that you've done for us in the past 13 years and everything that you've given us.
She always fixes bad situations. My mom constantly has to be the hero and swoop in and save the day.
One night, she made cucumbers. And, I love her because of that also.
I love when my mom takes walks with me and plays with me at family game night. And sometimes when we take breaks and she draws with me.
My mom is the best because she gave birth to me.
I love my mom because she will always forgive me.
Mommy, let me play TV or not.
I love my mom because she gives me lots of love.
And she lets us have chocolate milk.
Mom, you're the best mom in the world. I wouldn't trade you for anything. You give me unconditional love no matter what, and you're always supportive of me and give me a lot, and I don't know what I would do without you.
Mom.
She's a great leader, parent, businesswoman, and role model, and I would be happy if I grew up to be anything like her.
Sometimes she lets me go to work with her.
My mom's the best because she does a lot of great things. I'm always going to be a mama's boy.
I love you, Mommy.
Love you, Mom. Mom.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Love you.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers and everyone else.
Join us as we sing this wonderful hymn, I Will Praise Him.
When I saw the cleansing fountain open wide for all my sin, I obeyed the Spirit's wooing when He said, "Will thou?" I will praise Him. and wash away each day. Blessed be the name of Jesus. I'm so glad He took me in. He's forgiven my transgressions. He has cleansed my heart from sin.
Before we begin with the word today, I'd like for us to pray together and invite God to speak to our hearts through His word. Lord, I come before You in this moment with the realization that my words have no power, but Your words have power throughout all generations. The Word who is Jesus, the Word which has been given through the Holy Spirit to the prophets, to the New Testament writers, to all those who listened to Your voice within their spirit. And these things have been preserved by Your grace that we might read these words and reflect upon them. We thank You for the opportunity to hear these words, and may You give Your anointing not only on the preaching, but on the hearing of Your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. One thing for sure every one of us have in common is that we have a mother. We have different moms maybe in our life who've made a difference, and that's the case in my life. I think of my mother, who passed 25 years ago, and yet there were wonderful, glorious years, of course, living under her encouragement and the joys that we shared, and a great example to me in many ways. And even though she's been gone a lot of years, there's still a special place in my heart as I reflect upon her, and I do so not with sorrow or sadness every Mother's Day, but with delight, knowing that my mother is in heaven. She's celebrating with her Savior, and I'm grateful for that. But I have other women who've been in my life who are mothers. Charlotte Matherly. And I want to say happy Mother's Day to you, Charlotte, and thank you for the grace that you bring into our family, our extended family, that you've brought joy. And for my children who never met my mother, they know you as their just precious grandmother, and I'm so grateful for that. Then there's my mother-in-law, Audrey, and I wish her a happy Mother's Day and thank her for the blessing that she is, and that she brought into this world the most precious mother to me now, and it's my wife, Loretta, and how much I cherish her as a mom to our two wonderful daughters. I also think that each of us are facing uncertain times, unusual times, and mothers during this kind of time have so much to deal with, and if your children are very small, you are having to entertain and be the teacher, and you're the probably chief cook and bottle washer and all of the things, plus working from home, trying to block out distractions, and it can go on and on and on. And I celebrate you today, and I hope that you'll be encouraged from this message to continue on in the grace and the strength of God, and not give in to the things that the devil wants to whisper into your heart and into your mind, and know that God is for you and He is with you. Moms are such a tremendous example. And there's one mother that stands out in Scripture above all the rest because of her child, not because of who she was. And that's Mary. Mary can be to us a very powerful example. But even as the mother of Jesus, she should not be an idol. There are those within the Christian tradition that elevate Mary to an unwise and unhealthy place. It's simply not a biblical place. We pray to God, our Father, through Christ the Son. He is our intermediary, not Mary. There are those who do that with others in Scripture as well. There are those that would look at the Apostle Peter and say, for the fact that Jesus spoke to Peter and said, on this rock I will build my church, that somehow Peter has been set up as the leader and there's a line of succession for leading the church. But that's not biblical either. Jesus was, is, and always will be the head of the church. Remember that He said to Peter, I will build my church. It wasn't Peter's church, it was the church of Christ. And that key might have been given to Peter for a short time, but Jesus still holds the title deed. The Apostle Paul called out people as he would write to the churches and teach them that there was a tendency among people to idolize those that were leading the church. And they would say, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos. And still others, they would say they would follow. But that wasn't the right way to do things. And to elevate someone to the place that God alone and that Jesus the Son alone deserves to have in our life and in His church, that's idolatry when we go outside of that. And that still goes on today. People will have what some call preacher religion. And I like this particular preacher and that one. And that's not good. We should never elevate anyone to the place that only God should occupy. And Paul wrote, follow me as I follow Christ. And I think Mary would echo those same sentiments. She would say, only look to my example as I follow the example of our Savior, who just happened to be my son. You know, it's surprising to me as I began to prepare for this message that Mary is not mentioned as much as I thought she would have been in the New Testament. She's mentioned 19 times in the New Testament, and some of those are repeats of the same scene, but I only find 9 unique situations in those 19 occurrences. And in those 9, we find some insight on what it means to be a mom, but not just a mom, but an example of how all of us should live, whether we're a parent or not. These are great principles to live by. And in Luke chapter 1, we want to look at this passage, which typically is only read around Christmas time, but I wanted to begin there today. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give to him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Verse 38, she says, "I am the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. There's already one profound example that we should follow after in these verses, and it is the example of being willing. She says there in verse 38 of chapter 1, "I'm the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." You know, Mary trusted in spite of all the evidence that would have told her this was simply not possible. Verse 37, God declares through this angel, "Nothing is impossible with God." And Mary trusted in spite of what the circumstances were pointing towards. She had lived a pure life. She knew how things usually worked, and this is not how things usually worked. And yet, even that knowledge of her own purity and how God brings children into the world, all of those circumstances, she said yes to God. We very often tell God why something cannot be, instead of saying, "God, I'm not sure how it can be, but I'm sure of you. I'm sure of your knowledge and your power." And so it's an important lesson for us to learn right off the bat that Mary, when confronted with an impossible scenario, decided that she'd be willing for God to do the impossible. She'd be willing for God to do whatever it was. She said yes to God. Very often we tell God, "Yes, it can't be." But I want us to remember that a number of months ago we shared out of the book of Romans chapter 4 and verse 17, this verse, that the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. In that message, in that teaching from months ago, I asked you, and you would come down and you gathered rocks off of the front altars. I'm not throwing them today. You gathered them and you were to write on the back of that what you were going to believe God to do. What was He going to call into being? The God of the impossible. And so we ought to learn the lesson of surrender to this God of the impossible, to be willing for anything that He wants to do, to realize in His power and in His character, it will always be the best thing, the right thing. And Mary said, "I'm the Lord's servant. May it be to me as you have said." How powerful could our families be if we would say yes to God, if we would lay down our will and say, "I'm willing, God, for you to do whatever you want to do." There's another thing. We don't have to go too many verses later in Luke chapter 1, and we see another example. It's in Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 56. I'll not read all of that, but it is Mary giving praise and honor to God. It really comes out of her spirit. It's a song of praise. I think about growing up and hearing my mother sing at home, and in the car, even at church, and using her gifts and talents in that way. It was a lesson to me to have a song in my heart, a song that overflowed. And moms who truly worship, now it's not just through singing, it's through service of some sort. Whatever gift God has given you, an ability, worship is not not just confined to a verbal expression of song. It is all of our life. That's true worship. And when a mom expresses praise to God from the overflow of their heart and their kids see that, it's a powerful example. They learn to worship. You know, I think about a church that gathers together, even where you are today. Do you have a heart of praise? Is it overflowing from your experience with a God who has forgiven you of your sins and you want to ascribe to Him worth and give Him honor, tell Him that you love Him? Our praise towards God through whatever medium it comes out, it should be infectious. Others should be drawn to it and say how they love their God, how they love Jesus. It's a powerful example. There's a third powerful example. It's in chapter 2 and verse 19. It's also this same verse is repeated in verse 51. Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. This is when they had made some comments about, here he is, this child has come. And they marveled at what was said by the shepherds and the angels. They marveled at what was said when they arrived in the temple. And she treasured up all these things. She reflected on them. She was a prayerful person. She was a prayerful mother. You know, what God wants for our kids is what truly matters. We have all kinds of goals and desires for the young people in our life. The attitude Mary displayed was one of seeking reflection and desiring the input of God before anything else and everything else. Mary did not understand all of what was going to transpire. That was simply not possible for her to know. And so she reflected on this. She let the Holy Spirit reveal it over time. We ought to be very prayerful about our kids' lives and not planning ahead of God's timing, ahead of God's revelation of His purpose. We pray over all kinds of things. Do you pray over your children? You would probably say yes, but how do you pray over them? I pray over my family in all of life that the Holy Spirit would guide their affections, their aspirations, what they dream about, what they long to do. That would overflow into the attitude of their life, how they're going to approach life, seeking to honor God and all they say and do. And it would be reflected in their actions. Those are things that I pray for them very particularly, those inward things. But I pray that God would give them their direction for vocation, either studying many might just choose a career and go that path. I pray that they could select the right friends and God would bring the right people into their life. I pray over future marriage for them, whether God wants that for them or not. But no matter what, learn the lesson of pondering in your heart and waiting on God's timing and learning to pray about all of it. There's another lesson. Mary and Joseph bring Jesus on the eighth day to fulfill the requirements of the Mosaic law. And they bring Him in Luke chapter 2 and verse 22 to present Him to the Lord. They were required to do this as a presentation of the firstborn. It was a special day in the life of a Jewish family. It was done with a prayerful, worshipful approach. It was an opportunity for them to present Jesus to the Lord in sight of the priest and witnesses as the firstborn. He was being consecrated and set apart to the Lord. It's kind of a funny thing to me in that whole ceremony, but they were fulfilling the law. This really was for Mary and Joseph. They were trusting. Mary trusted God with this child that she was going to have to raise. She knew she was going to have to look to God in all of this. She trusted God to say, I consecrate him to whatever your will is. I wonder if you trust God in today's present circumstances. I want to speak very plainly that this is the kind of environment which will deepen our trust in God, or we will be overcome with fear. And the way you are talking in your home and the actions of your life are teaching those around you if you trust God or if you are consumed with fear. Your kids are learning lessons from you now. I'm not saying put up a good face or front, but I am saying that your attitude and your actions ought to reflect that God's in total control of your life and that you trust him. Mary trusted her kids. I wonder, do you trust your kids to God in this environment? Or do you think that it's you've just got to hover over everything absolutely all the time? There's a time and a place for our protection, but it is always under God's protection. Another thing is, this is one I kind of wrestled with talking about, but it's a scene that comes out of Jerusalem during the feast of the Passover one year, and Jesus is a boy. His family have been there to celebrate the feast of the Passover. And as it concludes, they must have traveled with a large group of people, family members and friends, whoever it was. And they're going back home, and they get a day away and they realize Jesus isn't with them. He got left behind. And so they turn around, they go back to Jerusalem. And the scripture tells us in Luke chapter 2 that they search for him. They finally find him. He is in the temple courts. I guess I can imagine for a period of time how frantic and frazzled they would be. But when it goes day after day and they're tremendously concerned about that, can you imagine what she was thinking? I gave birth to the Son of God and I lost him. How amazing. But in verse 48, Mary says to Jesus, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." And Jesus' response was that it should be obvious to you, Mom and Dad, I'd be in my Father's house. Where else do you think I would have been? Stay with me on this one, because it's sort of like going around my elbow to get to my thumb kind of logic. So you see, Mary and Joseph were focused on finding their son, the Son of God. And in their responsibility, they instructed Jesus the way they thought best. I think we should learn a lesson that you kind of have to read into the story a little bit to think they taught Jesus lessons and they weren't afraid to necessarily be wrong or make mistakes. Jesus was a perfect child. But they, even in this situation, they weren't concerned that Jesus would be happy with them coming to not necessarily correct him, because again, he didn't do anything wrong, but to speak to him as a parent. I think that in our society, we idolize our children. It's ironic that Mary and Joseph didn't idolize the boy Jesus. They worshiped the Savior as they knew it later. But if you've set up your family structure to be the kids are in charge and you idolize them, and being their buddy more than anything else is your goal, it's going to bring harm, and you've set the wrong goal. Mary loved Jesus enough to be his mother and to risk the mistakes that inevitably take place when we are parents. She risked being wrong. She risked being even chastised by the Son of God in order to honor this role that God had given her to be a mother. There's a lesson here for children too in relation to our parents. Imperfect children can be obedient to imperfect parents Because we look at the one perfect child who's ever been, and he was obedient to his imperfect parents. God gave within the Ten Commandments one particular commandment that relates to the parent-child relationship. God said, honor your father and your mother. And he gave a promise, when you honor your parents, that God will bless life. So what do we do? We must learn from Mary and from Joseph to be a parent, knowing that we'll make mistakes, but trusting that that's the role we must have first and foremost. Our kids will be grateful for that. We're to be bold. That's another thing. In John chapter 2, Mary asked Jesus for a favor. There's a wedding. Jesus has not performed any kind of miracle as at least to this point. There's nothing that he's done publicly to reveal who he is. And she comes to Jesus in John chapter 2, and she says, Jesus, they've run out of wine here at the wedding. And he basically says, why are you getting me involved in this? My time has not yet come, he said. So she asked him to do something. It wasn't to heal anybody. Nobody was dying. Really, the only thing she was thinking about is, Jesus, could you save these folks from embarrassment? And the lesson I take away from this is that it is okay to ask God for the desires of your heart. She was bold. I see that the heart of Jesus is one of compassion and care. He mildly rebuked his mother because her request was made out of her timing and out of her anxiousness. And we can't know everything of what he was thinking and what was transpiring. And yet, here she was. She was bold. That's the good part. We should place our requests always in terms of God's will. Ask whatever you wish, but always ask in God's will. In John chapter 7 and verse 6, Jesus challenges his brothers. They wanted Jesus to do public miracles, things to prove who he was. Even his brothers did not believe in him at that point. And Jesus responded to them. He said, you know, although your time is always at hand, my time is not yet come. We often want God to do things on our timetable. And we think that we just can boldly go and demand and command God to do things. God welcomes bold prayers. But God does not respond to presumptuous prayers. And a godly mother will pray bold prayers. And she will ask for many things. But the godly mother will always say, do whatever he asks. Mary didn't tell Jesus how to answer the problem. She brought the problem to him and told the servants, do whatever he tells you. And so bring your request. But do whatever God tells you to do. Leave the answer to God. There's another one. There's only three more, and we can move through quickly. Mary teaches us how to be adaptable. In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they all record Mary along with the siblings of Jesus coming into a situation where they wanted to take charge of Jesus. They were concerned for his welfare. They might have thought he was a bit crazy. And Jesus is teaching, and they send someone in, go tell Jesus to come out here. We want to take care of him. And they say to Jesus, your mother and your brothers are outside. And Jesus said, my mother and my brothers are those that do God's will, those that are a part of this faith. And they may have been concerned, and they wanted to bring him out to confront him. How ironic that they thought God needed help. We do that sometimes today. We say we trust God's way, but we try to help him out. Here's kind of a point that I want to drive home in being adaptable. You see, parenting has a release point. My friend Mike Rash told me a number of months ago, we were talking about kids and moving on and transitions of life. And he said, Brian, he said, you give them roots to grow and wings to fly. our role as parents and mentors within the church family, with any child, with young people, our role is to learn to ground them in a Christian worldview, a biblical worldview, so they can navigate all the circumstances of life. They've got that right thing inside that helps them. You can't do everything for them. You have to teach by words and teach by example, and then allow them to learn when the tests come. They've got to do it on their own. Our relationships have to grow and adapt over time. You can't parent your child the same way at age 15 that you did when they were 4. And you best not try to parent your 4-year-old as if they're 19. You see, Mary's like a lot of us, loves children deeply, is concerned no matter the age of our kids, but she also can worry. And those things can blind us from the right things and prohibit us from letting go and trusting God. That's what it really goes back to. We have to be adaptable and move along in life. And another thing that I see in Mary's life as an example is it happened at the cross. And Jesus is giving up this human existence. And in John chapter 19, verse 26 and 27, he tells Mary, "Dear woman, here is your son." And he tells the apostle John, "Here is your mother." Mary's really the recipient of this example. She's loved by God. It's a beautiful expression on the part of Jesus that God Almighty really is speaking a continuing care, this deep love for this earthly mother. God didn't select Mary because she was flawless. God selected Mary because of His wisdom and grace. And God doesn't choose any of us for any purpose of our life because we are flawless. He calls us because of His great love, and His all-sufficient grace is enough. Every one of us make mistakes, and we will still be loved by God. We're going to have hurts, but God promises never to abandon us. We're all going to face confusing situations, but God will provide the people we need, the resources that we need to make it through. He'll say to us, "Here's the help you need." Live each day in this knowledge that God loves you deeply, the way Jesus demonstrated He loved Mary. And here's the last one. It's in Acts chapter 1. We see this final particular mention of Mary in Scripture. And she's huddled together with the early believers. They are constantly in prayer. They are waiting for the Holy Spirit to be poured out as Jesus promised. And in the very next chapter, chapter 2, we can quite easily assume that Mary is present still when the Holy Spirit comes at Pentecost. Mary is the only person to have served as a temple for the second person of the Trinity, Jesus, and the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. She's empowered just like the rest of us to be witnesses for Jesus. The Holy Spirit rested upon Mary, twice touched by the Spirit. It's the greatest example any of us can be for our children or for others, is to be witnesses for Jesus. And this is where Mary takes that role to be a part of God's kingdom work. She had been a mother, and now He is her Lord. And when you and I are touched by that same Holy Spirit, we're empowered to tell the story of God. We're empowered to teach God's ways in how we live our life and by understanding Scripture and sharing it with others. And in all of that, this church of Jesus, Spirit-filled men and women, mothers and fathers and young people, all of us, when we're filled with the Spirit, we become a force to transform the world that God has placed us in. This morning, you may have thoughts that God is placing within your mind and in your spirit, drawing you in one of these ways or another, and you would want to talk to God about that. And as I pray, would you join me and you make your peace with God? Our Father, I thank you for the example that we have in Scripture. There's so many pitfalls along the way of life, and yet you are sufficient in your grace for every need that we have. And for the one who in this moment would want to yield their life to you completely by asking forgiveness of their sins. Lord, I know you hear their prayer right now as they confess, God, I'm a sinner. I pray you forgive me. I believe Jesus died for my sin. I believe you've raised him from the dead. I place my faith for eternal life in the facts of Jesus' death and resurrection. God, for those that are fearful, who have a hard time trusting or being willing to leave things to your perfect plan with their children or their own life, those who are overwhelmed by the circumstances of these days, I would bind and rebuke Satan in the name of Jesus over their heart and mind. And may they, as Paul told Timothy, not give in to a spirit of timidity, of fear, of anxiousness, but to see that there is a spirit that comes from God that is of sound mind, thinking the right thoughts, one of power, living in the Holy Spirit's strength and discipline, self-control, coming to you and trusting you to guide life. God, you know our needs, and so we present them to you today in the name of Jesus. Amen. As we've shared together today, thank you for being a part of an online experience that is meaningful and worthwhile. And as God has shared something and done something in your life, would you reach out to me? Several did this past week, and it encourages me to hear what God is doing. And so I hope that you'd make that connection. You'll see the things on the screen and knowing how to reach out to us. God bless you for your faithfulness to give and to support and to pray and to be the church of Jesus Christ wherever you are. God bless you.